Hello everybody and welcome at our GCP Mindset channel. Today we have a topic which is very new for me as well. We speak about clinical research in Albania, and I have with me here David Rosenbaum. He is an expert in clinical studies in that area, and I'm happy to welcome you.
Thank you.
So David, thanks for being here to discuss with us the topic clinical research in Albania. And you know, I've done already a lot of studies and managed a lot of studies worldwide, very interesting regions I have recovered already. But I didn't do any study in Albania yet. So I'm very curious about what you have to tell us. But let's start with yourself. Can you tell me a little bit about you?
Yes, Andreas. So first of all, thank you very much for inviting me for a video interview. My name is David Rosenbaum, and most of the people know me as a hipster of clinical research. So I'm relatively young and very enthusiastic about clinical research, and I'm doing clinical trials since the past 10 years, 11 actually already. And it's my passion, and this is what I do, and it is visible on the way how we do our work.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah, I agree. I also recognize you as a very enthusiastic person, and that's what I like. Yeah. And tell me a little bit about Albania. So I think I'm not the only one who don't know anything about this country. I looked on the map, of course, to see where it is. That's what I know now, but that's actually all.
Yes, so Andreas, everyone was asking me, and they are still asking, why Albania? And actually the reason for that is that when I have been at my previous employer, actually there for the first time I've heard about Albania. And I got in touch with the people there, the investigators there, and actually when I looked also at the statistics, for example, when I looked in the past clinical trials, I didn't saw Albania participating that often in the clinical trials. I started making a little bit of research. They have 2.8 million population. The hospital system is very interesting. They have private and public hospitals. And I have to say that Tirana, as capital city, is also well developed in terms of the hospital networks. So yeah, this was the main reason why I started experimenting sort of with this country, and it started to paying off because sponsors are being more and more interested, because this is a clinical trial trial naive country. So the patients, they almost 90% of the patients have never participated in clinical trials. And also, the standards of healthcare in Albania is very low. So this gives opportunities for the clinical research, because this way the patients, they have access to the innovative treatment they otherwise would not be able to afford of or to get hands on.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I completely agree. It's not always the size of a country, not the number of people living there, but how many patients can be treated, and how healthy is the healthcare system in these regions is also very important. Great. Can you tell me a little bit about the regulatory framework in Albania?
Absolutely. So since Albania is relatively new to clinical trial, also the regulatory requirements are quite easy. So the thing is that if you decide to submit a clinical trial in regulatory authorities in Albania, you only have to make one package. You prepare the package and you submit it to Central Ethics Committee, and that's pretty much it. In terms of the regulatory authorities, such as we know as the German Bundes agency for
the BfArM.
BfArM, exactly. Yeah. The BfArM, or for example in Slovakia, ŠUKL, which is the national regulatory of the drugs. This agency in Albania still doesn't act as a body who has to provide the approval. They are being only notified about the clinical trial or in terms, in case there is a serious adverse event or adverse event, they are being notified. A report is being submitted to them. Apart from that, you just have to have an approval from the Central Ethics Committee. And of course, you have to make a notification and receive an approval from the hospital director before the start of the clinical trial, which is pretty easy. And it is shortening the timelines for regulatory drastically. If you have to compare it, for example, with Romania, where at the moment the approval timelines are between 6 to 8 months. Sometimes I have been a witness of obtaining approval in Romania within 1 year. And if you compare it to Albania, you just have to wait for 2, maximum 3 months, and you are already initiated and good to go with the trial.
Okay, yeah, that sounds interesting. It's a bit similar to Germany, but 17 years ago. Actually, when we just notified to the competent authority. Yeah, interesting.
Exactly. That's why Albania is like a hidden gem. You know, it's also like Bulgaria 20, somewhere like 10 or 15 years ago.
Yeah.
This is the beauty. We found a country that is still able to be shaped.
Yeah, yeah, very good. Tell me a little bit about the industry in Albania. Do you also have pharma companies or biotech companies, whatever, young medtech, yeah, medical device companies? Is it existing?
Yes, so so far there are several pharma companies, but usually they are mainly interested into export and import of the treatment. Because as I have mentioned, the healthcare coverage system is very limited. Just a recent example we have done throughout our feasibility analysis for a treatment of multiple sclerosis in Albania, the only reimbursed treatment is interferon. Whereas, for example, in Turkey, you have available over 20 treatments who are being fully reimbursed. So you can compare this also, for example, in Bulgaria you have other biological treatments available. So if you compare this gives you a clear statement of what the opportunities are, because definitely if you go to the patient and he's being prescribed only interferon, and if you tell him like, listen, we have a new innovative treatment, but it may be possible that you get a placebo for a certain period of time, it is much easier for the patient to consider the risks and benefits.
Okay.
So this is big advantage. As for the pharma companies, they are, but as mentioned, they are focused on import and export of the drugs and other treatments. In terms of the biotech, I'm not aware that there is any Albanian biotech that is seriously shaking the market. And of course, as whole Balkans, Albania is no exception to that. There are also sort of like a small healthcare startups who want to make the mark on the map of the world.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Interesting. You just mentioned already import export of study medication. Do you need to get an import license?
Yes, so you have to obtain an import license, but this is being done after you obtain the approval from the ethics committee, and it takes usually up to 1 week, maximum 10 days to obtain an import license. The procedure is pretty easy.
Yeah, can it be done by you, or does it need to be done by the sponsor, or by whom you can support?
Usually how we are doing it, sponsor is issuing a power of attorney and we are acting in his name and we are receiving the import and export license.
Okay, perfect. Great. Let's speak about the investigators, because good investigators are the key. How good are the investigators in Albania? You said they are not so experienced with clinical research yet, but what's your feeling? Are they motivated?
Yes, so I think it's similar to what you have mentioned, Germany 15 years ago. For example, I will compare it again to Turkey. In Turkey, if you submit a feasibility request for COPD, you will get at least 50 or 100 investigators who are experienced in this indication. For Albania, for example, you might find between 5 to 6 investigators who have experience in the treatment of COPD, and out of those, maybe half have performed in the past some sort of clinical trials. So investigators, if you are searching for experienced seasonal investigators, you will find them in Albania, and you will count them maybe on one hand. But this gives a good opportunity because the investigators we are working with, they are very motivated and willing to learn and gain the experience during the clinical trials. What we have find as a solution for this is providing an experienced study coordinator. So we are having study coordinators who are being regularly trained in other countries where we are working with experienced investigators such as Bulgaria, Turkey, Slovakia, or Czech Republic, and then they're getting this international experience and they're applying it in Albania. This is helping to the whole study team because they are sharing the experience. The investigators are learning from the scratch, which is sometimes better because you, again, you shape the investigators in the way you expect. This is much better compared to an experienced investigator who has 20 years of experience behind his back. And if you try to show him something innovative or new, you know, he might have some sort of a resistance, which happened to me very, very often, for example, in Bulgaria with many professors. So on one hand, the investigators, they are not as experienced, but they are very willing to learn. And also, this is a very potential, or I would find the benefit in the lower experience of the investigators, which can be weighted with the lower salary expectations for the investigators' grant.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah. I think actually when people are curious and motivated, as I said already, then it sometimes counts more than experience. As long as they still want to learn something and want to develop in the right direction. But what is with the language when you say you have study coordinator support from Bulgaria, for example? I assume they don't speak the same language.
Well, the thing is, study coordinators are fine with English. The investigators in Albania, they do speak English till some extent. You cannot expect like a native or fluent English language, but they are able to orientate themselves in the EDC completion, in the source data writing, etc. And if there is some barrier in the language, that's the role of the study coordinator who helps to the investigator in the translation.
Okay, yeah, makes sense. You said already the competent authority of Albania is not too much involved yet in approving study, but it's just a notification. How does it look like in terms of inspections? I mean, when they are just getting notified, I guess they also don't inspect studies.
Exactly.
Yeah.
At the moment, these authorities do not inspect the studies, whereas, for example, the Slovak and Czech regulatory authorities, I have observed in the recent times that they gained the power and they also started inspecting other European member countries, which is for me, as a native Slovak person, I'm very proud of. As for Albania, the local regulatory authorities haven't started the inspections yet. Also, when it comes to the European or international audits, Albania has not been subjected yet to the, for example, to the FDA regulatory audit.
Okay.
Yet we are planning to, or at least I personally, I have been part of many FDA pre-audit inspections, and also during the COVID-19, like last month, I have been preparing one site in Bulgaria for the virtual FDA inspection. And being ready and prepared is a key element to the success. So this is what we are implying also to the Albanian sites. We are always with that one thought on the back of our mind that this can happen anytime, and that's why the quality of the work has to be perfect from the very first moment, from the, I would say, from the site selection, because this is the most crucial moment when you see what are the pros and cons of the sites, where what has to be improved, what is sufficient. And this is very crucial.
Very good point. There's another topic I would like to discuss with you. I looked also on the corruption index. You know, there's an international one, I think, from the World Health Organization, and there the it's ranked quite low, which means there's a lot of corruption in Albania. But it's not divided into business areas. Just see, there is a lot of corruption in the country. How does it look with corruption in clinical research?
So I would lie if I say that there is no corruption. Of course, Balkan is notoriously known as the region of corruption, and. Every sponsor who decides to go to Balkan countries, they have to have this thing on their mind. What I have developed as a strategy throughout those years, and it has been proven effective, is in case, for example, because it happened to me in the past, you know, like hospital director also in Albania, he said like, oh, why should I send the lab samples to the central laboratory if I can do it in my local laboratory and take more money for it, you know? And I spoke with him and I explained him, listen, Mr. Director, this is a sponsor requirement. This is an international protocol, and every single site has to follow these guidelines and these requirements. If you decide to take the samples and send it to central laboratory, and for example take the samples and send it also to local laboratory, you are violating the protocol, and this is a very serious issue, and you can be easily prosecuted for that. But on the other hand, if you are following the guidelines and if you prove that you are site with a high quality, you can look at it in the future perspective that you will be ranked with a good rate, and you will get more business in the future. And this is the problem with many sites in Bulgaria, and like the business in general. They do not see the long-term perspective. The problem on the Balkans is that everyone is trying to make the profit in a short term, which is very bad. But sit with them, and if you explain them that this is not about short-term money making, but it's like a long-term investment that can show off as a very beneficial, then they realize it, and then they don't make any problems with this.
Yeah, maybe it's even an international trend to make fast money instead of long-term relationships. But that's another topic for another video. Let's continue with COVID. And I think you will agree that we have huge changes or experience huge changes during the last 20 years, let's say. Yeah, we changed from paper CRF to ECF. More or less everybody uses a CTMS system. Randomization is usually done electronically. We have more EPRO systems involved. And of course now, and due to the COVID crisis, we also need to do more and more remote monitoring. How does it work in Albania? Do you have a stable internet, for example? Do you have all parts of the country connection, or can we expect some problems there?
No, so in terms of the internet connection, luckily the fact that the whole Balkan region has joined the technology development later than other countries, the internet connection is pretty awesome. For example, Bulgaria is ranked as one of the fastest internet countries around the globe. So this is good. The internet connection is fine. And also in terms of the performing monitoring visits, we have experienced this also in Albania. So between March and May, we had to stop the monitoring and we had to do it remotely. Also, there were many requirements from the hospital that no one is requested, no one is allowed to enter the hospital because they were forming the COVID-19 units, and there was still this initial chaos of spreading the virus, etc. At the moment, the situation is fine. We are again allowed to enter the hospital and to perform the monitoring visits. However, we are always ready to combine it and make it sort of a hybrid hybrid research, so that, for example, we go to the site once in 3 months. We make it a little bit more intense, and in the meantime, we are doing the remote SDE, or we are trying to keep the regular phone contacts on a weekly basis or on a bi-weekly basis based on the protocol requirements. So yeah, I mean, the technology allows us to also conduct the work remotely, but always I'm a little bit old school in this. I always prefer the on-site visits done in person. All of that is the connection with the study team and with the investigators is on a totally different level. If they get to know you, get to see you, get to shake your hand.
Yeah. I completely agree. And as you know, I would also prefer to make the interview face to face with you, but we need to take it as it is in the moment, and therefore it works also remotely. And it's actually good to hear that you have better internet than we in Germany, because our internet connection is not the best. Okay, let's say I would have a client, a sponsor, who would be interested in running a study in Albania. What would you recommend? Yeah, let's say it's a asthma study. I think asthma studies work well in these countries. So actually the expectation is it's feasible to run the study in your country, but what do they need to consider to start a study there? What are no-goes if they move to this country?
So there are several facts that has to be considered before providing the full answer. One of them is, what is the timelines? Are you short on time? Do you have sufficient time?
Always as soon as possible. Time matters more than 20 years ago.
Okay, so in this case, I would decide to go for private practices where the investigators are not required to have the approval from the hospital director. And also the time for the contract execution is much shorter. So we get the contracts. So we done, of course, the feasibility first. We, for example, select which are the best sites. I would rather focus on the main regional cities. So for sure, Tirana, the capital, Then I would go to Shkoder, eventually Durres and Flora, to have, for example, three sites in Tirana and other three in the smaller, but which are the most important regional cities. Then we would go through the investigators database, and based on the feasibility questionnaire, of course, we would select the investigators who are with the highest recruitment estimations. And after that, we will just see the profile of the sites that is as per our requirements. So we are searching for the fast initiation. In this case, as I mentioned, I would go for the private practices, where you don't need a hospital director approval. So we just submit to the ethics committee, we provide all the information, we have to translate those documents in Albanian, which are the drug-related materials, patient-related materials, the protocol synopsis, which may take between 1 to 2 weeks based off the volume of the document.
Yeah.
And voila, you are ready to go. And also, good thing is that if you say to the investigators that, listen, guys, this is serious project and we need to be fast, in the process between signing the contract, submission, and the SIV, some of them are really willing just to go through the database and do the pre-selection of the patients.
Okay, great. Sounds good. You just mentioned already the contract, and when you involve GPs, it's easier to make the contracts. What is, if you involve university clinics, for example, do they accept English contracts?
So they require bilingual contracts. This is the requirement. When you so there is one most important hospital in Albania, which is University Hospital of Mother Teresa. This hospital or this research unit is the most experienced when it comes to the clinical research. And of course, having a big university hospital, actually, this is one of the biggest in Albania.
Yeah.
You have to be aware that the timelines are a little bit longer.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you very much. I learned a lot, and I'm pretty sure that we will move also to Albania with one of our future studies because it sounds really interesting, and I see a lot of opportunities, and especially when I know that we will have in some countries poor recruitment, then it's a good alternative to go to a new region. Yeah, thank you.
Absolutely, Andreas. Be my guest, and I'm more than happy to share with you this experience of this beautiful hidden gem.
Yeah, great. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay, thank you very much for listening and watching our video. I hope you liked our video about clinical research in Albania and you learned something. I at least learned something. Thanks for watching us. Please leave your comments, subscribe us, send us your questions. Take care and bye-bye.